Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Aparuta de sangamatasa tawara ye sorvanta bhamunchantu satang. Today is the opportunity that we gather here at BIA to reflect on the Buddhist teachings. Those of us who are interested and have practiced, followed the teachings, have received benefits of doing so. So this will be my 53rd Pancha this year, training as a, living as a Buddhist monk in Thailand and in England. And the whole point of the reason why so many people are in the West have an interest in Buddhist teaching, where before, say 50 years ago or so, very few people showed any interest, like in the United States, where, you know, there wasn't not that much interest in other religions. Buddhism was just some religion in Asia, and without any real understanding of it. But back in the 1950s is when I became acquainted with Zen Buddhism, and this sparked off an interest. I was 21 years old at the time, and something in me just resonated, like faith, interest arose immediately when I was reading some books by D.T. Suzuki, who was a Japanese writer in English on Zen, Japanese Zen Buddhism. What is it that interested me that would carry me through a lifetime pursuing the goal of trying to understand what the point of human existence is about, to be able to see and understand the frustrations, the anger, the suffering that one created in one's own mind. As a youth, one tended to blame external sources for suffering. You know, so, you know, the whole conditioning process, cultural conditioning, is you tend to blame parents or the government or teachers or the neighbors or whatever for the fact that you experience suffering. The thinking mind, you know, we develop the thinking process in a high degree, so we can read and write and we can think. But what actually happens when we think is that we create suffering. Because thinking itself is a function that we acquire after birth. And it's based on criticism, about discrimination, about discerning the differences between good and bad, heaven and hell, right and wrong. So when we get caught in the thinking process, when that's how we interpret our experience about ourselves or our lives or about the world around us, you know, we end up always feeling critical, something missing, there's something wrong. There's this hope that in the future we'll be able to have the kind of perfect democratic governmental systems and fair and just societies, rule of law, and that everybody will be happy then in the future when this kind of ideal of progress fulfills itself. But this whole idea of progress is a thought. It's a creation that depends on other conditions, because where there's progress, there's regress, there's degeneration. Now, the Buddha was not, in his teaching, he wasn't talking about perfection on the conditioned realm about how things should be. And the goal of life is to create conditions that are at their best, but to understand the nature of conditions, of phenomena that we experience, such as the condition of our own physical form, our human body, the conditions we create through the thinking mind, through seeing, through smelling, tasting, touching, hearing, the sensory experiences that we have to live with through a lifetime, we reflect upon. So the basic teaching was that the Buddha propounded after enlightenment was the Four Noble Truths. Now this is a very interesting approach to take suffering, dukkha, in the Pali word dukkha, translated as suffering, and put it in a category of a noble truth. Because usually we, you know, most of us, before we encountered Buddha Dhamma, always thought dukkha was a nasty fact of life that we want to get rid of as quickly as possible. So this is the wisdom of the Buddha, was to take something quite ordinary. It's not kind of extreme forms of misery that he was pointing to, but just the simple fact of sense of dis-ease, the sense of lack, something wrong, something you've got to get, something you've got to get rid of, something needs to be changed. This sense of there's something not quite right, we have to make it right, is dukkha, is suffering. As well as gradations of suffering from torture to disease and so forth. But the noble truth of suffering, what is noble and true about suffering is it is a fact that we experience, everybody experiences, whether it's ancient India, whether it's the Prince Siddhartha of history or the present situation, male or female, rich or poor. So the Buddha took the most common, ordinary experience of humanity and put it in the category of a noble truth, to be understood. Now to understand suffering, you can't just try to blame it on others anymore or analyze why you suffer, but to recognize it. So the aspect of the first noble truth, the statement there is suffering, it should be understood. So to understand something, you have to accept it and observe it, witness it. And so this understanding of dukkha is not, you know, an analytical understanding. It's a recognition. Dukkha is like this at this present moment. So this became very much resonated with my interest in life at that age, tender age of 21, because I was suffering a lot from doubt and self-criticism, and I was in the military and I was unhappy, didn't like military life. So much of dukkha I was creating, so much of suffering and wanting something else, not wanting to have things the way they are. And this taking this first noble truth of suffering and understanding, and I began to practice, you know, to later on, not at that time, but later on as I read more, understood the Dhamma more through reading the scriptures, reading various treatises on Buddhist meditation, I began to see suffering in terms of a noble truth rather than as some kind of personal flaw or personal identifying it with myself as a physical human being, a personality. So understanding suffering, you don't need to know why. The Buddha never asked the question why. Why is life like this? Why do we suffer? made the statement of an obvious fact that we can reflect on. Suffering, there is suffering, it should be understood. And then the third aspect is the insight. The insight in has suffering has been understood, is understood. You know it, no longer seeing it in trying to analyze it or personalize it, but to suffering is like this. So we have in the Buddha's teaching these statements of things are what they are. The Pali word dhatata is like, it's suchness or as isness, it's like this. Binyang ni eng in Thai. It's a way of reflecting upon the way things are without describing them as good, bad, right or wrong, giving them any added adjectives or descriptions to try to understand suffering. It's merely the immediate recognition of suffering is like this. This sense of worry, anxiety, confusion, doubt, fearing the future, fear in all its forms, worrying what other people think, worrying of feeling regret about things you've done in the past. The past, you know, we say things or do things that we regret. We remember them. We suffer. The future is the unknown, so, you know, it's potential success or failure in the future, things going well or not going well, and we all know that in the end there's death, that we're all going to die. Now, suffering then is to be understood. And then the second noble truth is the cause, the origin of suffering. And so this is a very powerful meditation, the second noble truth, because it mentioned like the three kinds of desire, the cause of suffering. The origin of suffering is due to this ignorance of Dhamma, not understanding Dhamma, not knowing Dhamma. We tend to create a world of good and bad, right and wrong. We tend to create conditions around us that are going to disappoint us and fail us in the long run. So there's Gama Dhanha, desire for sensory pleasures through seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, touching. Gama Dhanha speaks for itself. What we see that is attractive, we want it. We want the beauty, we want beautiful music, we want fragrances and pleasant tastes and so forth. And so Gama Dhanha is not difficult to understand for most of us, but the second noble truth is Bhava Dhanha, with Bhava Dhanha, desire that wanting to become something. We feel we're not good enough the way we are, so we want to become something better. So it can be desire, you know, ambition or aspiration towards something good. It can be, you know, a wholesome desire. Desires aren't necessarily unwholesome or bad. Bhava Dhanha, we usually start meditating because of Bhava Dhanha, with something inadequate, something I'm missing, some lack in my life, something I've got to get that I don't have right now, is the motivation to meditate, to bhavana. So, and we begin to reflect on Gama Dhanha, sensual desire, Bhava Dhanha, desire for becoming, third desire, Vipava Dhanha, desire to get rid of. Desire to get rid of defilements, get rid of anger, get rid of fear, get rid of jealousy. Now, the whole emphasis the Buddha made about, you know, how to deal with the first noble truth, second noble truth, is this reflective ability. As I said before, it's not figuring out why or analyzing, but it's this, what we call reflecting upon. It's like this, like when I would investigate these three kinds of desires, I could see that so much of my even attempts at meditation were bhava-danha, you know, wanting to attain something I didn't have, or wanting to get rid of defilements or negative thoughts or bad moods or anger. So I, being, you know, you take these words like gamadana, pavadana, vipavadana, and then you investigate them. You observe them, you know. You try to think in your own way of just wanting something, you know, that you see that is attractive and wanting it. That's gamadana. You can observe dana, you can observe, witness dana, gama dana, you can observe bhava dana and vipava dana. This is called contemplating or reflecting upon the origins of suffering. So how do we reflect upon it is what the word mindfulness or sati sampajanya, intuitive awareness, apprehension, comprehension of the way it is. So you know, this is a way of investigating, exploring, researching through the Buddha's direction, the Buddha's teachings. Gamadana is like this. And you begin to see that which is aware of desire is not desire. Awareness is not desire. Desire, all three kinds of desires arise and cease in consciousness. Consciousness doesn't arise and cease, but desire does arise and cease. It comes and goes according to condition. So with mindfulness, with sati sampajanya, you know, this emphasis on mindfulness these days is quite interesting worldwide. Because mindfulness is our way of realizing the amata dhamma, the deathless reality, dhamma itself. We ask ourselves, you know, in chanting morning pujas, we do reflecting on the qualities of Dhamma, such as santitiko, akaliko, ehi pasku opanaiko, bhajya tang vei tidapo vinyuhi. So like in monasteries, in our monasteries, we do this morning and evening pujas. We say this, chant this in Pali. Santitiko Dhamma, here and now. So we ask ourselves at this moment, what is apparent here and now that all of us are, can witness, can know, can observe. And it's, you know, so it's not about finding an object. It's not about the room or the Buddha Rupa or myself. It's not seeing an object as apparent here now, because Dhamma has no form. You can't objectify. You can't personify Dhamma in forms or symbols or anything else. Dhamma is here and now. And what is apparent here and now for each one of us is that we're experiencing consciousness, conscious awareness. That's apparent, isn't it? That's a fact that you can't deny. None of you in this room could deny that you're not conscious at this moment. But it's, you know, it's not an object. They can't see it or hear it, but you know without analyzing or trying to figure out that your consciousness is the experience, the apparent here and now reality of this moment. Santitiko or Kaliko timeless? Can you try to figure out what timelessness is with thoughts, with analysis? You know, words cannot describe timelessness. So you have to say time and less, you know, no time, timeless. But what is timelessness is not something that you can qualify or objectify. It's not a phenomena, but it's here and now. And so this ehi pasiko is to come and see, you know, it's like right now I'm inviting you to observe. Consciousness is like this. You know, it's knowing, it's here and now. It's not knowing about things, it's the reality of knowing, of being the knowing in this present moment. So Dhamma is never something separate or outside or far away. It's always apparent here and now, timeless. Encourage, you know, the ehi pasiko is like to come in, an invitation, an encouragement to come and see. And we're not going out, we're not looking for Dhamma as some object or find it in some other place. So the reference is always with mindfulness, isn't it? Where you're not seeking something through seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, touching, thinking, but observing the state of mind. Dukkha is like this, suffering is like this. Dhanha, desire, is like this. It arises and ceases. That which is aware of suffering, aware of desire, what is that? You know, so in the Thai forest tradition, the Luang Por Chah would always, you know, encourage us to use the Puto mantra, the form of the name of the Buddha. Means to know. It's the knowing of reality at this moment is like this. So this second noble truth, the insight into it through investigating desire, the three kinds of desire, you have the insight into letting go, because out of ignorance, out of not knowing Dhamma, not rest, abiding in Dhamma, in mindfulness here and now, we've trained ourselves to not be here and now, to be here and thinking about something else. Not to recognize, to think that we've got to get something we don't have yet. It's a creation that we make in our lives. You know, I've got to get something. I'm not good enough the way I am. I've got to get something else from outside. Is a thought, you know, is an ideal that you have, that you're attached to. And wanting to get rid of things, what you don't like, you create this desire to get rid of things is another attitude of thinking and observing and judging that you are attached to. And that which is observing desire in its various forms is non-desire. So mindfulness is non-desire. It's consciousness aware of itself. Its consciousness has no form, has no qualities other than knowing. It's not discriminating. Consciousness is not discriminatory. It's not about right and wrong, good or bad anymore, but it's the way it is. So consciousness knows the way it is, that all conditions are impermanent. All Dhamma, so when we chant, you know, one of the two basic teachings for Vipassana meditation is Sabbe Sankhara Anicca. All conditions are impermanent. All Dhamma is non-self. So in the second noble truth, this sense of letting go. Now I really, years ago when I was living in England, I did a whole, spent 2 years exploring Paticca-samuppada, dependent origination, because it was a teaching that tended to mystify me, because most people say it's about three lifetimes. So in, you know, most of the books in Theravada Buddhism talk about Paticca-samuppada as a kind of theory of three lifetimes, the past, the present, the future. But as a three-lifetime theory, it doesn't give us anything to practice with here and now. It's interesting in itself, but it's merely theoretical. You can't prove that. You can't prove you existed in the past or what you'll become in the future. You know, you can fantasize, you can create scenarios if you want. But that's not Dhamma anymore. It's might be interesting intellectual exercise, but it's not the way out of suffering. So, and then I read Tenja Kunputatat's book on Paticca-samuppada. So this stimulated this interest in exploring this teaching, because it's simultaneous arising. There's this other interpretation that it's about here and now. Paticca-samuppada is about here and now, not about three lifetimes. So Tenja Kunputatat, Tenputatat used to say that, you know, you start with something like dhanha upatan, desire and attachment, clinging to desire. So, you know, in investigating Dhamma during that time that I was using the dependent origination teaching, I would explore this, how the, you know, I got to know the three kinds of desires in myself as they arose. I began to recognize them. The puto, quen ru, the present, to know the present moment, to know that desire for sensory pleasures like this. Then to see it in terms of, you know, how, you know, if I'm not heedless, if I'm not mindful, then I'm naturally attached to that. I want to get what I desire. That's upatana, or clinging or grasping desire. Same applies to bhava dhanha, wanting to always get something, get achieve states, get jhanas, get samadhi, become a stream emperor, become an arahant. You know, this desire, aspirations and desires to attain these desirable states, and began to recognize this, you know, bhava dhanha as I was, you know, as it would arise in my consciousness. And the same with vipava dhanha. I began to notice and observe the desire to get rid of things, wanting to get rid of anger, wanting to get rid of fear, wanting to get rid of jealousy. Wanting so much, as a personality, I wanted to get rid of, that I could, you know, vipava dhanha was like a great revelation to me, because most of my life I'd been living with vipava dhanha, you know, trying to, you know, I was brought up as a Christian, where you're trying to attain sainthood, and you're always trying to get rid of things. And so, you know, it was a condition, strong condition, and which I brought with me into the Buddhist world. And then through this investigation of the Four Noble Truths and the dependent origination, we began to see that this is vipava dhanha. I had a name for it. Began to see it, you know, it seemed right. You should, you know, you want to get rid of anger or something, you know, just get rid of fear. Everybody wants to get rid of these negative emotions. So it's kind of natural for, you know, for us to want to get rid of them. But it's done with avidya, or ignorance of Dhamma. So when we awaken, to Dhamma, we're not just going along with desire to get rid of things, but we're seeing it's a condition arising and ceasing. Sape, sankara, anicca, all conditions are impermanent. And then you have the insight that that which is aware of Dhamma, this mindfulness, sati sampajanya, is not desire. Desire is something that comes and goes. But awareness is still, it's silent. It's with us all the time. It's Dhamma, it's ultimate reality. It's real, it's not just a fantasized, created idea of some heavenly state of mind. So from when I practiced, living with Luang Por Chah in the early years of my monastic life, letting go, as I began to see the result of attachment to views and opinions that I had about how I saw Luang Por Chah or the Sangha Wat Pah Pong or Thai Buddhism, began to, see how I tended to, form, I had certain views about how things should be, ideals about how a monastery should be. And, created by me through the cultural conditioning. So this is an interesting thing to explore, is the way we relate to ideals. Now, being an American, the culture of America, of the United States, is based on ideals. So it's very ideal. We're brought up to be very idealistic. And the cultural conditioning is based on, freedom and rule of law and democracy and equality. And all these are very high ideals about how things should be. And so this idealism, as you apply it to, to the country you're living in, the society you're existing in, and to yourself, it's never, you end up being critical and end up, as you get older, becoming cynical about everything. Because, as I grew older, I began to see the United States talked about freedom and equality, but that really didn't exist all that much. A democracy, a very fine ideal. So when I met Nong Pon Cha, and his emphasis on Dhamma, the way it is, when I began to feel sometimes about second year at Wat Pah Pong, I became critical of some of the monks. And thought that some of the practice, the way of life was degenerating. So I went to see Luang Por Chah in his kuti one evening and told him my views about what's happening and kind of expect him to straighten it all out. And all he said was, Wat Pah Pong Ben Yang Nie. Well, this is the way Wat Pah Pong is. At this point, not justifying or denying what I'm saying. And suddenly I had the insight, that this moment, it's not the ideal, moment, but it is the way it is. And this is a way of reflecting the way it is. Ben Yang Ni Eng. It's like this. It's a way of receiving the present moment and understanding it, rather than criticizing if it doesn't live up to your ideal of what you want at the present time. Or if it has, if it's an ideal moment, it's not going to stay there. Life is a continuous changing process. So we have peak moments where everything is what we like and want, and we're perfectly happy with it, and then it changes. You can't sustain ideal peak moments, just like your breath. You can't just inhale without exhaling. So through this letting go, this insight into the second noble truth, letting go of desire. It's not suppressing desire. It's not trying to get rid of it, but through mindfulness, through patience, you begin to allow desire to arise and cease. And you're the puto, the witness of the presence and absence of desire. So it's like bhavana is really this way of training yourself to remind yourself, really, of the present moment, is here and now. And whatever you find you're obsessed with, if you're obsessed with some kind of thoughts, or you're bored, or doubting, or whatever, we tend to attach to that. We either try to suppress it or get caught up into believing it. But in terms of insight, it's to let go of it. It's the attachment that's the problem, not the condition itself. And as you trust yourself to let go of desire, then you see the end, the nirodha, the third noble truth, the end of suffering, the cessation of suffering. It's not a suppression of desire. It's not an annihilation of desire. It's merely a relaxing your grip, this blind gripping tendency, habitual tendency to grasp desire, and see that you don't have to do that. With mindfulness, with wisdom, you remind yourself to let go. And then your letting go has been realized, leads to nirodha, or the absence of suffering, the cessation of suffering. Then this is the path knowledge of the path of the liberation. It's when we realize nirodha, the absence of grasping, absence of suffering, absence of self. Because consciousness, awareness, is impersonal. It's not my kind of mindfulness. I can't own it as a person. My consciousness has no form, as I was saying before. It has no, it's not, we think consciousness is within the body. We generally assume that we're conscious, that the consciousness that we're experiencing now is inside us. And that's the materialistic view of life, where we create a whole world that we believe in and trust in, based on the fact that consciousness is within each individual separate human being. But in Buddhadhamma, we're in consciousness. At this very moment, all of us are in consciousness. Consciousness is one. It's not personal. It's not my consciousness separate from you. So consciousness is here and now. It's anatta. It's non-self, non-personal. And mindfulness is what we call the doorway or the gate to this realization. Mindfulness, the path to the deathless. In the Dhammapada, one of my favorite verse from Dhammapada, Appamado Amattapadang, mindfulness is the path to the deathless. So this is the deathless. You know, we're identified with everything that is born and dies out of avicca, out of ignorance. We identify with the physical body, which was born, gets old, and dies. We're identified with our emotions, which change according to situations. We identify with our memories, with our fears, our anger, our greed, our desires, our sexual desires. We cling to all these identities to create a separate self. And what we're doing is we're clinging to mortality, to death. You know, because all these conditions are sankharas that arise and cease and change, sape sankharani cha. But what isn't sankhara in this present moment is awareness. Or putto, using the mantra of the Buddha's name. Or you can let go of putto and just awareness. That's enough, just mindfulness here and now is peace, is stillness. So then consciousness through the senses is impermanent. So when the eye contacts the object through perception, consciousness arises on an object. That's sensory consciousness. But consciousness itself is infinite, is invisible, it's here and now. It's what we're all experiencing here and now, and as we awaken to that, begin to recognize that rather than just not recognize it, right? The continual habitual patterns of identity with the body, with the thoughts, with the memories, with the emotions, then of course we're bound to suffer. The cause of suffering . So what I'm saying is for reflection. I'm not trying to be dogmatic or anything, but encouraging this awareness, because this is the very essence, the heart of Buddha Dhamma. Buddha, used the Four Noble Truths as a way of recognizing the presence and the absence of conditions. Using the word dukkha or suffering as a noble truth. Because all conditioned phenomena, good or bad, right or wrong, will take us to the unconditioned, the unborn, uncreated, unformed, consciousness itself, awareness. This is our gate, our door, entrance point at this very moment to amattatam, the deathless reality of Dhamma. Nirodha, then, the insight, third noble truth, is to make it clear, once you have the insight into the absence of suffering, the end of suffering is like this, to trust this insight. So then your practice is really path knowledge. It's stream entry, it's path knowledge. You know the path, how to meditate, how to power, and it's no longer theoretical or depending on techniques and various other things. The path is reality itself. And to make that clear, in other words, to trust it. So over the years, you know, there's been my main practice. You live a life, you know, live most of my monastic life in England, where you're head of a monastery and you're involved in establishing branch monasteries and ordaining, became upachaya and so forth. But by the time all this happened, there was still, you know, you're still busy with external conditions. Fair enough. But the practice of bhavana was the important one. Not to forget that, not to dismiss it, but to use it in daily life, integrate it into the daily life that one must live, you know, with the whatever state, whatever condition you find yourself in. What I've realized is, you know, the ditta is peaceful. You know, it's pure. It's here and now. It's knowing. It's not, you don't go into a kind of a trance or become a zombie or anything. You don't lose consciousness. But you, consciousness, awareness, non-grasping of conditions, being aware, you know, as you bhavana or reflect more and more, recognize the arising and ceasing of conditions as you're experiencing them. It's no longer about theorizing about Buddha's teachings, but actually putting them into practice. They're all very practical, like Four Noble Truths, the Dependent Origination. These are practical teachings. They're not doctrines that you grasp. They're like directional signs. So what are they directing? You know, rather than going out into the sense world through the senses, you're mindful of the feelings you're having, the mood you're experiencing at this moment, the thoughts that arise and cease, the body as it's sitting here, the sensations, the sensitivity of your own physical body you become aware of the body within consciousness rather than consciousness within the body. And this kind of insight, you know, it brings Dhamma into reality because it's a perfect whole, it's complete, it's perfect in itself. You know, Dhamma is perfection. It's here and now, and it's what aligns us with everything, talking about the climate change and difficulties and, you know, there's so many problems in the society all over the world and so many wars and conflicts and people blaming each other and terrorism, and so every day there's some kind of new terrorist attack in some country on the planet. Why is this? Because we all feel separate, threatened by each other. You know, if I identify myself as this physical form, this is my identity, and then I see the world around me as kind of dangerous. You know, it's you're out there, I don't know what you're thinking, and seeing myself as in a vulnerable position. The physical body is very vulnerable. You know, if a human body is not a really tough form, it's easily damaged. So the suffering of dividing the world and oneself is through the thinking process. You do that through creating it. The world is separate from me, and I'm separate from the world. Or in terms of Buddhadāsa, we're one in consciousness, in Dhamma, in reality, ultimate. So with all nature. So it's not just humanity, but includes everything. Now, trying to figure this out with the thinking mind is, you know, I found impossible, actually. It's more of an intuition. It's insight. What in Pali, jnana dasana, it's insight, understanding, that can't be expressed through words, which are very limited to discrimination, to division. Thinking is about dividing everything, comparing one thing with another. But intuitive awareness, mindfulness, satisampajanya, satipanya, is embracing the universal through this simple act of awareness, knowing the present moment is like this. So do I still have time for questions? Or I hope each one of you have a question to ask.
Sadhu.
Hello, Ajahn Sumedho. I'm very happy to see you, and I'm very grateful to see you. My question is that, as you look at Buddha as one of the aspects, you look at Buddha, and you mentioned in your talks to be a superb teacher, which he is, fascinating that time. What would he do, or what should it be done in the education system today?
Well, the modern education is based on materialism. It's acquiring knowledge. And of course, it's an information age with internet and high technology. You know, and so you're endlessly acquiring more and more knowledge without understanding Dhamma. You know, so like education is about acquiring knowledge from external sources, from books, from teachers, from internet and Wikipedia and on like that. There's endless opportunities now for acquiring knowledge about any subject, anything you're interested in. And so, you know, that's to recognize that is acquired knowledge. That you get from external sources. Insight knowledge through bhavana, through meditation, is wisdom knowledge. It's not acquired, you know, from some external source. It's here and now, and it's with us here and now. It's not something that you lack. It's just something you haven't recognized. You haven't awakened to it yet. So, like with mindfulness, it's this awakened state of consciousness awakened to itself, rather than, you know, where then panya or wisdom can operate. Like you can inform consciousness, you know, you inform yourself with wisdom after a while, rather than just depending on what you know, wisdom from philosophers or sages of the past. It's innate in us, it's natural to us when we begin to meditate, to develop awareness, recognize that this is the opportunity that we have in this mortal state that we find ourselves, that we're identified with the human form and the sensory world that we're experiencing through the human form, individual forms. What unites us is consciousness, not equality in the sense we can't make everybody the same, you know, because each individual person is thinking something different at this time, you know, so what I'm thinking or you're thinking is not going to be the same, but what is uniting, unitive, universal in this very moment is consciousness. And so that's our refuge when we chant Tammang Saranang Gacchami. That's the real meaning of refuge in Dhamma. You know, it includes, it's not divisive, it's not particularly me as a human body, a personality, a separate personality taking refuge in something called Dhamma, which, you know, first you don't even, you think it's some kind of abstract ideal of reality or ultimate truth. But it, you know, it's much more than just an ideal or some kind of abstract idea, but it's a reality of here and now. And so it's called awake, like Buddha. The word Buddha itself means awakened. An individual, you know, awakened to reality is what the Buddha is. So education we all benefited from it, has its benefits, but it also, the more knowledge you acquire, the more you think, the more you suffer. You know, so you can endlessly create scenarios of misery and anger and resentment and indignation over what's happening in the world through thinking about it. And it's not that that's wrong, but, you know, we're helpless victims of our thought habits. Where awakened awareness, we begin to have perspective. We put thinking, we put feeling, we put experience into perspective of the here and now, rather than just operate reinforcing old habits, thinking habits, emotional habits that we've acquired early in our life.
Hi. Firstly, I just want to say thank you for your talk today. And the question I have is the same question that you walked into Ajahn Chah's room and asked him about, you know, you don't like what's going on in the temple as before. But my question in real life is, you know, you spoke about terrorism, you spoke about the America. The thing is, we talk about differences in people who are afraid of different religions or whatever, and then, what, you know, terrorism happens. But the thing is, the question I have is, I have a problem dealing with society at the moment, meaning, like, for example, what's happening in America, all the wars that it's invading these various countries. You know, I mean, the thing is, I mean, I see greed. I don't see that they're paranoid or they see the indifferences, but rather, you know, war for money kind of things. I mean, I'm really having a lot of difficulty dealing with this. You know, I just want to ask you how can I use Dharma to deal with this, because I find it so troubling that, you know, in this day, you know, 2019, we're still killing people because they want to make money. So that's my question.
Stop reading the news. Because it's probably going to get worse. You know, so, I mean, in my youth, you know, we had hopes that democracy would win, and we had this ideal that progress would go on and make things better. And so, the, you know, you had this faith in progress. But then in Dhamma, you realize that, you know, progress can go so far and then it goes the other way. Just like an inhalation and exhalation follows. And this isn't kind of a defeatist thing, but the good sign of this time the positive sign, that this is my opinion anyway, is this interest in mindfulness. Like when I went to live in UK in 1977, you know, you talk about mindfulness, no, you know, it's a common enough English word, but nobody really was interested in it. Even the Buddhists, you know, they were interested, are you Zen or are you Tibetan? Are you Mahayana? They're talking about different Nikayas and groups of Buddhists and what you believe and so forth. And mindfulness was almost never mentioned. And now it's the word of the day. You know, the mindfulness teacher is all over the place. And I think this is a good sign because it's what, you know, it's what's never been cultivated or developed in the Western world at all. And, you know, it's not a kind of, like vipassana or these kind of, you know, these kind of Buddhist meditation practices where we're not a part of culture, Western, European or Western culture, which was all based on, you know, this idea of Judaism, Christianity, the ideals of you're like you're born in sin, so you're kind of damaged goods the minute you're born, you know. So you get this feeling, you develop a sense of, you know, even though you may not believe that as you grow older, it's still this kind of conditioning influences how you see yourself and the world around you. And it's, you know, through meeting Buddhadāsa that I actually began to see, you know, how much, you know, the social, cultural conditioning that I'd received, which usually get, you know, the heavy doses of it in your innocent years as a child. You know, you just absorb, take things in, you know, whatever comes your way. And then, you know, in your teenage, you become more reflective, more discriminating. But the news of the day, you know, there's so many problems on the planetary problems, overpopulation, you know, and there's never been this many human beings alive at one time on planet Earth. And then there's climate change and the unknowns are rather daunting when you think about it, it's quite depressing because, you know, there isn't that much hope in the future that you could get, you know, 7 billion people enlightened and save the planet. You know, it's an idea we all want. But what's important now is to realize Dhamma, which is deathless reality. You know, so you're not just looking forward to the future as attaining some ideal, you know, governmental system, social system, and everything that fits an ideal. But, you know, as your refuge is in Dhamma, in reality itself, that's the only safe refuge there is for us at any time, in time of the Buddha or present time. So even though many of the conditions of planetary life are, you know, in state of change, that we can't, you know, we're not, you know, we're doing the best we can to try to slow it down. But the United States is not helping in any way, but there is awareness of climate change and they're trying to deal with wars and violence. But as long as there is this informing, you know, to see things as enemies, to create enemies, is the problem. You know, if I create an enemy, you know, then you know, that's what I'm doing through my thinking process. We see, you know, like Islam, or, you know, seeing it as an enemy, or terrorism, or Al-Qaeda, always in terms of these terrorists, these suicide bombers, and that is threats to us. You know, we create this sense of fear because an enemy always is, you know, dangerous to our existence. And that's a created perception that we do out of ignorance, out of fear, create enemies to, and in modern societies now, there's so much fear. Fear of immigrants, fear of overpopulation, fear of failure, fear of other religions. When you're attached to a religious form, you know, then you and it's out of ignorance that you're attached to whatever religion, even Buddhism, then we see other religions as wrong, as enemies. You know, so, you know, I was in Amsterdam last year, and some Venerable Soko and I were there, and we were walking by the canal, and some youth started yelling at us that we were persecuting Muslims. You know, I've never persecuted a Muslim. Well, you know, so they pick up this news from, you know, the media about what's happening in Myanmar, and Buddhist monks, you know, are involved with persecuting Muslims. And, you know, that's not Dhamma at all. That's not, you know, they're wearing robes, but they're not actually, you know, you can't say they're actually Buddhists. They're externally, you know, dressed like that. But that's not Buddha Dhamma. So, you know, and Christianity has a record, you know, pretty dismal record of persecutions. And but Jesus never taught that. You know, so the actual essential teachings of religion are overlooked for the attachment to the form, the external form of a religious group. Like Theravadan Buddhists can look on Mahayana as an enemy, or, you know, not as good enough, not as good, or we always have our defense of we're the direct and true and bearers of Buddha's teaching. We have views and opinions about that we have as Theravadans, that we form, and we can be aware of that as another view and opinion. It's not Dhamma, it's just belief. We believe in Thai Theravada Buddhism as being better than anything else as a belief. That's not reality. So, you know, as you awaken to Dhamma, you even your own prejudices, your own biases and views become apparent, you know, how you operate from assumptions you have about others or other races or women or men, or, and now all these gender problems, the LGBT situations and things like that. These are, you know, people have strong views about this right or wrong or moral or immoral. And as you investigate that tendency, you know, and your own is your own kind of own take on this subject, you begin to see what a viewpoint is about being right or wrong, moral or immoral, good or bad. And, you know, you see the suffering and how you can create a desire to get rid of that or change it or eradicate what you don't like. You do it all the time, you know, in meditation. We want to get rid of anger. We're teaching meditation retreats. I don't know how many times people would ask me, how do I have a problem with anger? How can I get rid of it? You know, I want to get rid of anger. I don't want to be angry. And that's a that's created by me, or by that person. They're identified with anger as their problem, and they don't want it, so they want to get rid of it. How do I get rid of it? You don't get rid of anger. Anger comes with is a part of the human condition. Sexual desire and anger, are kind of, these are primal kind of desires that are part of the human species. So it's not trying to get rid of it, but to understand it. And to not let anger or sexual desire be, what you're attached to and blinded by.
So any other question? Yes. Yes, please.
Thank you for being here. And thank you for the education you've offered and the insight into the self being a place of refuge from these things that we struggle with when it comes to seeing the suffering that's in the world. That's, I think, from the people who have spoken previously and in myself, the toughest cycle of desire and suffering is seeing the suffering of others in these terrible problems in the world, and then having the desire to do something about it and feeling the powerlessness of not being able to, or of not being able to affect it on a global scale. And finding refuge in the self is encouraging, but also in my life, in times when I have done that, it has also led to apathy. And so I guess my question is, in finding the balance between the desire that I have to amend suffering in others and also to have peace within myself.
Well, like the world is like this right now. This isn't a kind of resignation to misery. It's not justifying the way it is. It's just recognizing that at this time, the world that we're experiencing feels like this. You read about all these wars and children dying of starvation and terrorist attacks, and you feel this sense of resentment or anger or injustice, and we don't want that, because it is, it's all very negative, and a lot of it's absolutely horrible. But we can be aware of that, if we're attached to that, then we suffer. But what can you do at this moment for the benefit of all sentient beings is awareness. This is always our opportunity, no matter what. If things are unfortunate, things are happening to oneself or to others, the refuge is always in awareness. Then in terms of compassion, like from awareness, from Dhamma, come the Brahma Viharas, metta karuna mudita upekha. And so, our relationship to the world, to others, to other beings, is karuna or compassion. And mudita, joy at the goodness, the goodness of humanity, goodness of the world. Because when we think, when we hear the news is always negative about how, what's wrong in Middle East or South America or the United States or wherever. News is sensational news. It's always quite depressing or negative or arousing indignation. It shouldn't be like this. But there was meditation I used to develop, I still do, where you contemplate the goodness of humanity. Because in all situations, like like even in war zones and things like that, there's generosity, there's people trying to save each other, or care of the wounded, or just in the past, you know, the goodness of human beings through endless time, women nursing their babies, you know, that's an act of kindness that is quite ordinary, but we tend to forget it in terms of all the kind of atrocities that take place in the news, or even within war zones, the you know, the Red Cross or these doctors, nurses trying to help, the goodness of those actions are also part of the reality of this moment. They're not everybody's a beast and a terrorist and a vile kind of hateful person, but even within the conditions in various places, there's still goodness, kindness, compassion that we feel joy for. There's a mudita kind of experience, sympathetic joy for the goodness, the kindness, and just like being kind to a dog or a cat. No, I mean, these are quite ordinary, not like fantastically news-breaking events, but so much of our lives as human beings is based on kindness, goodness. You know, that we forget when we just accumulate the negative side of humanity. And then, you know, we do what we can. If we can, you know, stop a war, then we do it. You know, or try to encourage people to stop fighting. It's part like Buddhadāsa. He's trying to encourage people to keep moral precepts, 5 precepts. Encouraging dana, generosity. You know, the whole basis of our culture in Thailand is dana sila. You know, it's generosity, selfless generosity, and morality. So this is, you know, this is to be encouraged and to be praised and to be respected in human beings. And so, this is what we can actually do in a practical way. And I found, you know, thinking of just, you know, how many, you know, through countless eons of time, acts of kindness and goodness, generosity, morality, have taken place, you know, in so many ways that they're uncountable, you know. You can't count that, and that can be completely dismissed for the fact that there was a shooting in San Diego at a synagogue yesterday, and there was terrorists attack Christian groups in Sri Lanka and things like this. These are horrible events. But also, you know, the humanity is basically, you know, we're not evil, selfish, mean-hearted creation. We want to be good. We want to have ideals and live up to perfection and be free from conceit. And nobody, you know, wants to be conceited. We have problems with conceit and arrogance. We tend to operate from this ignorance of identity with a physical form and with mental states. But as we understand that these are not what we are, then there's nothing to be conceited about. You know, you feel the oneness of humanity, of nature itself.
Manasakan, Prajan. We have a question from the audience outside. The question is, could you explain about the Buddhist and scientific cosmology? are they compatible? And the other one is, how does it affect on Thai Buddhist belief?
Well, modern science is based on belief in materialism. So it's, you know, so it's, you know, cosmology is, or think in terms of Buddha Dhamma, there is a tremendous interest now in mindfulness, you know. So, you know, you're getting, some scientists are getting close to the more Buddhist understanding of consciousness being universal, rather than we're in consciousness rather than consciousness in the individual. But modern science term, you know, operates from that materialistic paradigm. We were each separate beings with the world separate from us. And that's, you know, that's why so many scientists have dismissed Buddhism as just another religion without understanding, you know, just some kind of belief system. Like most religions, you know, tend to, you have dogmas you have to believe in. And you start from, you know, like in Christianity, you start from, I believe in God, the Father Almighty. So that's in the creed. You start with the creed of a belief in God. Where in Buddhism, you know, in Dhamma anyway, you don't believe, you know, you're not asked to believe in Buddha or believe in a God. But there is suffering, there is the origin of suffering, there is the cessation of suffering, there is a way of non-suffering for noble truth. It's not dogmatic. And so it's for investigation rather than for grasping and believing. And that's one of the great attractions for me to Buddhism, was being brought up as a Christian. You know, you had to believe, and it was a sin to doubt or not believe. So, you know, I believe in God, and then you don't believe in God is a sin. What are you to do, you know, if you don't believe in God anymore, then you're basically, you know, a sinner in terms of a permanent, ongoing sinner. Where with Buddhism, or with Buddha Dhamma, in other words, it's not about, you think you have to believe in Buddha or believe in Dhamma. It's not. But these are terms they use for reflection. Like Bhutang Saranangachami can be, you can believe in Buddha, Buddha of the past, the Gautama, the Shakyamuni Buddha, and so forth. You know, because he was an actual, you know, historical individual. But we are, when we're taking refuge in Buddha, we're not taking refuge in somebody that died 2,500 years ago. We're taking refuge in awareness here and now. So, like these were the very strong points Luang Por Chah would emphasize about the reality of now, because this is all we have, you know, as experience is always here and now. And we can believe or disbelieve. We can. Some say there was never any real Buddha; it was made-up story. Others believe that there actually was Buddha, and we take it for granted. I just take it for granted that was, you know, because, you know, but it's not a belief I grasp, because even without that, even if it proved that there was never any Buddha, Buddha's teaching works, you know. It doesn't, it's not dependent on belief in a sage of the past or something in the past that we, you know, that maybe was an illusion. Because the actual Four Noble Truths is practical. It it's realistic. It's not based on belief of anything other than investigating, awareness, discernment.
So since we are a little bit late of time, can I ask for the last question from the audience, please?
Ajahn Sumedho, thank you for your talk today. I really appreciate the wisdom that you communicated through your talk, particularly your discussion of all of the various forms of desire and craving. And it often feels very overwhelming to me, because not only is there sensual desire, but then desire for status, and even in our relationships with people that we love, our friendships, we're always comparing and trying to position ourselves in our relative virtuousness and everything. I feel that it's very overwhelming and that in some sense hopeless. And then, you know, it's difficult coming from a materialistic educational background to believe that the moral quality of our intentions and our acts actually determines our consequences in our, you know, in our present and in the future, and that's difficult for me to make that leap of faith in that. And I guess, you know, people have brought up all the problems in the world, and that makes it even more difficult. Maybe you can address how we go about, on an individual level, seeing the truth and reality of the Buddha's teachings.
Yes, because, you know, when the self-view, the first fetter that blocks the path of liberation is the ego, called sakyaditti in Pali. This is identity with the body, that we believe that we are just this human form. And it's easy to believe in, because that's what we experience all the time, is the sensations of the body and the sensory input and the ability to perceive through the senses and so forth. So we're, you know, everything convinces us that this is what we are as a reality. And then we have, you know, we have ideals, like wanting a perfect relationship with somebody else is an ideal. You know, so we look for love and perfection and happiness outwardly, to think if we you know, that we, if we find the right person, you know, that we get along with and fall in love with, we'll be living happily ever after is a... You know, is an ideal that we hold when we're young. We don't as we get older, but it would be nice if it were like that. But this is where to trust yourself to be. This is the way it is. You know, the way you are. You know, it's not justifying any defects or flaws or faults that you have, but it's recognizing that, you know, you feel, you know, you get anger is like this, or fear is like this, or jealousy is like this, is a way of saying it in terms of what it really is, rather than seeing it as a defect in yourself as a person. You know, because you see, you know, when you see yourself as someone who's frightened, has a lot of fear, then you think a man shouldn't be frightened. You know, you should be brave and courageous and self-asserting. You know, ideals of masculinity, you know, are ideals. And so, you know, my generation was very brought up to be macho. You know, to be brave, not cry, and not show emotion, and men were strong and not weak, and so forth. And this is, and they had courage. They went and suffered from fear, and then you know you have fear. You don't feel courageous. You're scared of things. You feel threatened by others. You feel you shouldn't be. Then you create this, I shouldn't be, you know, I'm not a real man, I'm not good enough, I've got to become something, I've got to take some kind of self-improvement course or do something about it. Where with mindfulness, you're seeing the fear and being scared is like this. It's a condition arising that maybe have arisen, and you're aware of it. You're the awareness, not the condition. You know, you begin to recognize your true nature is awareness, not the condition that arises, which is very, you know, ephemeral. It's untrustworthy. No matter how convincing it tells you, you know, it asserts itself. And we oftentimes have, many people have this kind of internal tyrant, a self-critic that you can never do anything good enough. There's always something wrong, or you shouldn't have said that, or you shouldn't have done that, or you're not, you know, there's a inner tyrant, the inner critic can be, you know, a habit pattern that we've developed, turning the critical mind, the thinking mind, inward on oneself. And as you think about, you know, the ideal man, the ideal relationship, the ideal lover, the ideal husband, and so forth, is you know, these are beautiful ideals, not to dismiss them, but they are conditions, they're sankharas. Ideals are not reality. So, you know, as you trust your awareness more, that's what you develop a confidence in your awareness, which is what you really are, rather than what you think you are. You're not what you think you are. So, you know, I advise people not to believe what they think. I've got a book published called Don't Take Your Life Personally. It's a good reflection. Because we take it, you know, we take it all personally, like fear, jealousy, desire, sexual desire, you know, and then anger and resentment and so forth. These are all personal, identified on a personal way. So some people say, I'm an angry person, or I'm too greedy. These are creations you identify with this particular emotion. And it's like attachment, it's upadana, it's blind kind of attachment to a condition, because that's not what any of you are. You're not what you think, or you're not the fear that you experience, you're not the anger that arises, you're not the greed that arises. But it is, you know, greed is like this, so it does arise, but you're looking at it in terms of the reality of here and now. It's a sankhara of rising and ceasing. Trust that kind of reflective ability to break through the illusions you have about yourself as a limited personality.